Good morning, friends. Today we are going to learn details about quadratic equation. So it is a very important mathematical chapter for CBSE and ICSE both the boards, and it is very important for class 9 and class 10 both. So before that, we should go through the polynomial chapter. In my description link, I will give the link of polynomial chapter. So before starting the quadratic equation, you should go through the polynomial first. Okay. So basically, when I am making that video, that point of time I haven't thought that video will be too long. But basically, when I am going to cover the whole chapter, it's going to be a lengthy video. So you can pause if you feel any kind of boringness or any kind of hectic. But I can assure you, after completion of this whole video, it will be very, very, very easy for you to understand detail about the quadratic equation. And I am giving stress on the basics first. So if you put your attention on the basics first, and if it is clear to you from the base point, from the ground point, then you can do any kind of critical problem based on the same. Okay, so without wasting any time, we should start our video. Okay, let's start. Come on.
Okay, friends. Now we are going to start quadratic equation. And I have already written over here that quadratic equation is a very important topic for class 9 and 10, CBSE and ICSE both. Now, first of all, you should know what is it? Quadratic equation means what? Already in polynomial chapter, we have seen there that quadratic polynomial means a polynomial which is having degree of 2. Okay, so that way we can write that quadratic polynomial or quadratic equation, there is a slight hairline difference between a quadratic polynomial and a quadratic equation. So quadratic polynomial point of view, we know that 2 degree polynomial what are they like examples can be said I think it is still remembered you that means this kind of equation can be said as 2 degree polynomial where we can see the maximum degree or the highest value of the degree that is we can see over here that is 2 so that kind of polynomial expression we know that they are second degree polynomial or rather say they are quadratic polynomial okay and also we know that for a second degree polynomial maximum number of terms that must be maximum number of terms it must be less than equals to 3 not more than 3 but it can be equal to 3 like this or it can be single term polynomial also like 7x square it is also a second degree polynomial which one is having only one term okay now if this second degree polynomial or second order polynomial if this second order polynomial if this second order and second degree both are actually same second order polynomial max equals to 0 equal to 0 like this that example already been given suppose this one now it is becoming equals to 0 then it is becoming a quadratic equation understood until or unless that second order polynomial or 2 degree polynomial is not going to equals with 0 that time we cannot say that one is a quadratic equation I can say it is a quadratic polynomial but it is becoming a quadratic equation from quadratic polynomial to quadratic equation that point of time, that quadratic polynomial must be equals with 0. So when we are getting this kind of form, then we can say it is a quadratic equation. Understood? So for a quadratic equation, there must be some features or characteristic, like it must contain a single variable. A single variable means either that equation comes with x or y or z or any variable, but that should be a single one. Two or three variables can't be mixed for a quadratic equation. Okay, so it must contain a single variable and with degree of 2. That means one variable must be there, only one variable can be accommodated in a quadratic equation, and the degree of that variable obviously will be 2. That is the maximum exponent or the maximum power of that particular variable in that equation must be 2, not less than 2. If it is a less than 2, like this one 7x, it's a linear equation, not a quadratic equation. Got it? So if we come to express like a general form of a quadratic equation, how it looks? It looks like this one, ax square plus bx plus c becoming equals to 0. Now you can say that instead of x, can we put there y, z, a, b, c? Not a, b, c, basically by convention we are using a, b and c like a constant term, and x we are using here as a variable. So instead of x, you can put over y also or z also. Generally x, y, z, they are assumed as a variable, and a, b, c, they are assumed to be a constant. Okay, so that is a general form of a quadratic equation. Okay, now in this particular case here, that first term, or the first, rather say first constant, which is the first constant over here, a, it cannot be 0, cannot be 0, because you can see over here, if this a becoming 0, then that x square term will be vanished, because 0 multiplied with anything will be becoming 0. And I already told that a variable must be there with a degree of 2. So you cannot make that a equals to 0, otherwise this square term or the x square term will be getting vanished. Understood? And the second thing is that second b and c constant, b and c can be equal to 0. That's an interesting thing. You can make that b and c always, or it may be become, can be equal to 0, because if we put 0 in place of b or c, they will be getting vanished, then that polynomial quadratic equation becoming a single term quadratic equation. If this b and c becoming 0, then that equation becoming ax square equals to 0. It is still a quadratic equation, mind it. It is still a quadratic equation while b and c is equals to 0. In this particular case, when both of these constants are 0, still it is known as a quadratic equation with a single term. But mind it, this first constant, which was attached with the x square term, it cannot be 0. I think it is clear. So this one is also a quadratic equation. If you make only b 0 instead of c, then it will be look like this, ax square plus bx equals to 0, while in this particular case c is 0. So it is also a polynomial, a quadratic equation. So only I have to keep in our mind that the first constant, which is a coefficient of second order variable, you cannot make that constant 0. Okay, So that way, that is the basic introduction of a quadratic equation, from where we can see that a second order polynomial, if it is becoming equals to zero, then it can be known as a quadratic equation, where the one variable, a single variable must be there with the degree of 2, and the coefficient or the constant which is attached with the square term, it cannot be equal to 0. Rest of the constant, they can be 0. They must be 0, not really. They may or may not be equal to 0. Okay. Now, moving to the next part, which is after completion of this introduction, we should move that how that quadratic equation concept actually comes in our mind. Okay, suppose the simple concept is like this. Suppose a person is going to paint his wall. Now inside of a room, we have a wall like this kind of rectangular structure. And suppose the information is given to you that the area, it is, suppose it is a wall, rectangular wall. And the area of this wall, suppose it is given to you, that is 14 meter square. That means we all know that if the length is known to us, it is length, and it is breadth, then area will be length into breadth. We all know that. Okay. And one information is also given to you that length of the wall, suppose this kind of information is given to you, length of the wall is 3 more than 2 times of the breadth of the wall. Suppose this kind of a puzzle kind of information is given to you. A wall which is inside of your study room. Now you are going to paint that particular wall, and the area of that particular wall is given 14 meter square. And one additional information is given to you, which is a tricky one. Length of the wall is 3 more than 2 times of the breadth of the wall. Now you are asked that find length and breadth of the wall. Suppose this kind of a puzzle kind of mathematical problem given to you. Now how you can solve that particular problem? It's a very easy one. From that particular concept, you can realize that why we need to know regarding a quadratic equation. Just to solve that particular problem, we can start like this. Let the breadth is x, so that way we can say by the problem length will be 2x plus 3, because in information it is given that length of the wall is 3 more than 2 times of the breadth. So if the breadth is x, the 2 times of the breadth, that is 2x, and 3 more, that is added 3. So by the problem we can say now that this 2x plus 3, that is the length, and if it is multiplied with breadth, that will be the area, and that is equals to 14 meter square, isn't it? It's a very easy thing. Length into breadth, it is a area of a rectangular wall or rectangular anything, it is equals to 14 meter square. Now if we solve this particular equation, then we can get the value of x. Very easy. It's a kind of simple factorization. So after solving simplification of that particular equation, it will give this kind of a quadratic equation. Now this is a quadratic equation, you can see, because a single variable is there and the maximum or highest power of that particular variable, that is 2, and you can say it is a 3 term quadratic equation. Okay, now if you solve that equation, you can get the value of x, from where you can say that what is the length of the wall and what is the breadth of the wall. I'm not going to solve that particular equation over here. Okay. Afterwards, we are going to solve different problems. So that point of time, it can be solved. You people can solve that particular equation and find the value of x. X will be the breadth and that way 2x plus 3 will be the breadth of the wall. Okay. So from that kind of concept we can realize now that how or why we are going to solve or why we are going to know detailing about the quadratic equation. Okay. So now suppose we are going to solve a problem. After writing the statement, I am again coming back. Now a problem is given like this way. A train travels a distance of 480 km at uniform speed. If the speed had been 8 km per hour less, then it would have taken 3 hours more to cover the same distance. We need to find the speed of the train. So a train is traveling, in simple words, a train is traveling of a distance with a distance of 480 km, and the uniform speed means the speed is not going to vary. It is constantly during the journey, it will maintaining a same speed. Okay, that is the uniform speed concept. Now if the speed had been 8 km per hour less, that means if the speed is going to reduce by 8 km per hour, obviously then it will take more time, and that's why it is told it would have been taken 3 hours more to cover the same distance. Same distance means 480 km. Okay, so if the speed drops, obviously it will take more time, that's why it is told that 3 hours will be taken more. And you are asked that what will be the speed of the train. That's a question, it is taken from a NCERT textbook. So the solution is a tricky one. That given data, that is the distance that is given, and we know this particular relation from our childhood knowledge that speed is equals to distance by time. That is a very well known relation. It is also being used to solve different problems in physics also. Okay, now if we just cross multiply that particular relation, it will be look like this. Speed equals to distance, time equals to distance by speed. And why we are doing so? Because we are going to find the time requirement to travel that same distance. Because two cases are there. In first case, when it is traveling with a constant speed, the speed hasn't been reduced. And second case, when the speed is being reduced. And both the cases, if you compare them, then you can get first one will take less time, second one will take more time. And by how much? By 3 hours. That's why you are going to find out two time for two cases and going to compare them with these 3 hours. That is the main motto of this solving this problem. So let the speed, rather say initial speed, that means before reducing the speed, that's why I am written initial without reducing the speed. Initial speed is x kilometer per hour. Okay, now what we are going to do, that is the speed. So in this particular relation, this thing is that speed. Okay, so first case, when speed hasn't been reduced, that point of time, that time taken, I am writing first case, when speed is not reduced, that point of time, the time taken, that is nothing but 480 by x, isn't it? Because 480 is the distance and x is the speed, so obviously unit should be in hour, because 480, that is in, comes with a kilometer unit, and x is coming with kilometer per hour unit. So as a result, the unit will come like hour. Okay, similarly in second case, when the speed is being reduced, that point of time, that same thing we are going to find, time taken. So how much time will taken in this particular case? That same distance will be going to travel. So 480 will be there, and speed is being reduced by 8 km per hour. So x was initial and by 8 it is being reduced. So it is obviously unit should be hour. So I should wipe this thing, otherwise it will create more confusion for you people. Okay, so that unit will hour. Now first case without reducing the speed, that is the time taken. In second case after reducing the speed, time taken is that one. And there is a relation is given in between these two parameters. So we can build the relationship now. By the problem we can build the relation right way, this way, that 480 divided by x minus 8 minus 480 divided by x, and that will be equal with 3. I think it is clear to you now. If it is not clear, then just go to the statement again and check that if the speed is being reduced by 8 km, then the time will be taken more. So that's why that time will be more, because the speed is being reduced. And by how much time will be required, how more time will be required, what amount of more time required, that is 3 hours. That's why that minus this will be equal with 3. Now you have to solve this particular equation by your factorization knowledge. You can easily simplify that thing. Just subtract both of this term, 480 take a common from it. So after 480 taking common, and if you cancel it by 3, so the equation becoming like this: 1 by x minus 8 minus 1 by x equals to 480 is being taken common, and send it to side in this side. So 3 by 480, and it will be nothing but 1 by 160. Now again LCM of them and make a subtraction. Finally it will give, I'm coming this side, it will give a quadratic form of equation which will be look like this. Just solve it with your pen and copy. You can find this kind of a equation will be there. X square minus 8x minus 1280 equals to 0. It's a obviously quadratic equation because second order and equals to 0. So second order polynomial equal to with 0, that is a quadratic equation. Now you can solve it by doing the simple method, that is the middle term factorization. Middle term factorization means first term coefficient and the last term constant will be multiplied together, and then split that particular product by hook or by crook, by which addition or subtraction you have should come to the 8 value, or rather say minus 8 value. So I am factorizing that thing like this way: minus 40x plus 32x. You can check it with your copy also. It will come like this: 1280 equals to 0. And if you simplify that thing, so it will give you x minus 40 and x plus 32. So there you can see two roots are there. Roots are, I can wipe this side. I'm wiping this side because space is limited for me now. So after getting this term, you can see that two root is coming. One, x equals to 40 and x equals to minus 32. So I told you in terms of polynomial equation that a second order polynomial may have two zeros. That means maximum it can have two zeros. Two zeros means two roots. Two roots means these things. So zeros and roots, they are basically the same thing. That means if you put any value on that particular quadratic equation or on that polynomial, and if the value of that polynomial becoming zero, then that value will be zeros. And obviously that zeros values of that polynomial also known as roots of the equation. Okay, that way I can say that 40 and minus 32, they are roots or zeros of the polynomial. They are mean, basically they are same, roots and zeros. So I have already assumed x is as term of a speed, so speed cannot be minus 32. So in this particular problem we are neglecting that term, that minus 32 neglecting. Why we are neglecting that term? Because that speed cannot be a negative integer. That's why I can neglect minus 32 term, only accepting that 40 term. So the speed, need to find the speed of the train. So the speed of the train will be 40 km per hour. That will be the answer for that particular problem. And just I am solving this particular problem at the beginning of the lecture, by which it will make you more clear that from where that quadratic equation concept comes to us and how it can be solved also. Okay, so that way, that is a solution of a simple problem, which one is taken from a NCERT textbook. Okay, coming to next part. Now, just after solving that problem, we can draw two conclusion from there, that a quadratic equation, first one, a quadratic equation can have maximum two numbers of root. I'm underlining or highlighting that particular term, maximum. That means a quadratic equation can have only one root, but it can have maximum two numbers of root, not more than that. Okay, and second verdict you can draw, that roots means the zeros of that polynomial equation. Zeros and roots, they are basically the same thing. Okay, now one important thing we should know over here, that suppose it is a general form or standard form of a quadratic equation. That is a standard form of a quadratic equation, or general form rather we can say. If we take a common from there, A taking as a common, so that equation will be converted like this, x square b by a x plus c by a equals to 0. Okay, now obviously if this a is taking common and on the other side there is 0, so if you divide the a with 0, so that a will be cancelled. So that way I can write like this, that this particular term I am writing like this way. See, I think you people can understand, 2 into b by twice a into x plus b by 2a of whole square minus b by 2a whole square. This thing I am keeping in a bracket, so it will be more easier to understand. C by a. Just see, this particular line I am changing like this form. One thing should be noted over here, that is equal to 0 and a not equal to 0. That should be noted, since, okay, if a becoming 0, then the whole equation will be 0. That's why I should note over here that a not equal to 0. Okay, so now see this part, how it is coming like this, x square, copied x square, then b by a into x, intentionally, I am trying to convert that particular equation in a square form. Square form means a plus b whole square or a minus b whole square. In this particular case, I am trying to convert that equation into a plus b whole square. So that's why this particular second term I am writing, trying to write like a 2ab term. 2a means that b by a term I have considered like b by twice a, intentionally, into x is copied. So you can see 2 and 2 will be remain cancelled, so that will be remaining same, b by a into x, b by a into x. Just I am modifying that thing. Okay, and the third term, obviously x a square plus 2ab plus b square should become, b means this part, so b by twice a whole square. Now this term is basically additionally comes over here, so that should be excluded also. That's why minus b by twice a whole square I am keeping there. So that term and this term will be cancelled each other, and it will be remain same with this particular equation. Why I am doing this, just I am going to clarify that one. So from this equation, I am converting that thing like a plus b whole square. Okay, and that c by a, it is remaining same there. Now you can see from there, I can write like this way, x plus b by twice a whole square. Isn't it? Because a square plus 2ab plus b square, it will giving you x plus b by twice a whole square, and that second, this additional term, whatever I pull it over there, that will be remain there, and obviously c by a will be remain
Now that what we are going to do now, I am writing just x plus b by 2 a whole square minus, if you just couple them both, so it will give you like this way, 4a square will be LCM, and here you can see b square minus 4ac term will be there, isn't it? If you just, this one is a minus sign with a, and this one is a plus sign, so just taking a minus as a common, and 2a whole square, that will give you 4a square, so 4a square will be LCM, a simple subtraction process. Okay, so if we send this particular term to the right side, so it will becoming plus. Okay, if this whole term, if you shift them to the right side of the equal sign, then it will be becoming plus. So it can be written like this. I am removing this part. I think there is no problem at all. Now you can see that this whole term square is equals to that term. So that way, if any term like this way, I can put you an example, like x square is equals with 9. So that way you can write x equals to plus minus 3, isn't it? Why this plus minus is coming? Because minus 3, if you product them, also gives you 9. And plus 3 also gives you 9. That's why that plus minus sign should be reflected over there. So that same concept, if you follow over here also, so what it gives you? It gives you x plus b by 2 a, that is nothing but that b square minus 4ac by 2 a, and one root should be there, and along with a plus minus sign should be there. Why that plus minus sign is coming? Just because of that concept. Okay. 4a square, if you root it, it will come with 2a, and b square minus 4ac, our root sign will be there. Now from here you can see that kind of equation is coming from there. And now if we try to find out from there x equals to what, just solve it. So that plus term will be going to be shifted over right side, so it will be becoming minus, so that will giving you, it will be also 2a, so 2a will be a LCM. Minus b will come over there, and plus minus sign would be there, and b square minus 4ac remain stay there. Now this particular relationship I am trying to build, and it is a very important relationship for a quadratic equation. That's why I am trying to build that one. This one is not so needful now. That is the important relation I have to keep in our mind. And that equation will be used to solve or to find the roots of any quadratic equation. That means this equation will use to solve or to find the roots of a quadratic equation. Every time you cannot solve a quadratic equation by doing a middle term factorization method. So when that middle term factorization method is not works actually, that point of time you have to take by taking this equation into consideration. And how that equation actually developing, that is the basic derivation. Every time, in your exam point, from your exam point of view, it is not going to be asked that how that equation actually derived. But you should know from the basic should be clear that how that equation comes into picture or comes in front of us. So that is the basic derivation, a very simple derivation by which this equation can be developed. And that equation should be remembered always if you try to find out the roots of a complex kind of quadratic equation. So if you split that equation, I can wipe some amount over here, that if we split that equation, I said already that maximum two numbers of roots can be there. So one root if you express by x1, and the second root if you express it by x2, then the first root will be one sign. That means minus b plus will be taken account, b square minus 4ac by 2a, and the second root I can write minus b minus b square minus 4ac by 2a. So those are two different roots for a quadratic equation. Okay, and that formula is known as quadratic formula.
quadratic formula to find roots. Okay. Now from that particular equation, some very important conclusion can be drawn. I'm coming later, afterwards. Now see that this formula already we derived, x equals to minus b plus minus root over b square minus 4ac by 2ac. Now from this equation, some conclusion or very important thing can be derived, like the nature of roots. Nature of roots means the roots, whatever you are getting from that quadratic equation, by seeing or by observing those roots, or by observing the nature of that particular b square minus 4ac term, you can say what is the actual type of roots you are getting. Okay, is it a real number? Is it an imaginary number? Like this way. Okay, suppose the conclusion or verdict is like this, b square minus 4ac, that particular term is very important, only this root, under root term. Okay, this b square minus 4ac can be equals to 0. For suppose a kind of quadratic equation you are getting, where that b value and a value and c value such like that, that if you find this particular thing, that value is coming like 0. If b square minus 4ac is becoming 0, suppose a general form of a equation we know, or standard equation form, ax square plus bx plus c, that is equals to 0, we know. Okay, that is the standard form. These b and that b same, a, c, c, that is coming from there. Understood? Now already I told you that x1 can be written like minus b plus minus, x1 I am writing, so x1 will be plus b square minus 4ac by 2ac, and x2 can be written minus b minus b square minus 4ac by 2ac. That is the x1 and x2 term, two different roots, and if this kind of roots you are getting, so that will be the distinct root. So suppose first condition I am taking b square minus 4ac is greater than 0. In this particular equation you are taking seeing that b square minus 4ac is greater than 0, both the cases. So what will happen if b square minus 4ac is greater than 0? So root over of that particular thing will give you some positive value. Okay, so from both the sides, x1 and x2, if you try to find out while that b square minus 4ac is greater than 0, obviously they will give you some real values. It can be it can be plus, it can be minus, however it is, but it will obviously give you some real values. So while that b square minus 4ac is greater than 0, they will produce you, or they will give you some distinct real roots. Okay. Similarly, if b square minus 4ac suppose equals to 0, so if this term is becoming 0, so the root x1 will be minus b by 2ac, as well as x2 also will be same, isn't it? If b square minus 4ac is becoming 0, so that root term will be cancelled. So from x1 b minus b by 2ac, from x2 minus b by 2ac, both are same. So in this particular case, both roots are same, and obviously they are real. There is no doubt. Real and same. Understood? And the third condition comes like b square minus 4ac, the left one, that is less than equals to 0. And that gives you a very complex thing. If that b square minus 4ac, that is less than 0, that is a negative value. So under root of negative term. Under root of negative term is basically an imaginary number. It's a complex number. It is also known as complex number, also it is known as imaginary number. It's not a real number. And in your 10th standard, complex number is not there. So after crossing of 10th standard, you are going to face a mathematical chapter which is dealing with a complex number. And complex number is basically denoted by root over of minus 1, that is symbolized by small I. So from now, your level, you should know that while that b square minus 4ac is less than 0, that is a negative value, that point of time, no real roots will be there. That means imaginary number, imaginary or complex roots are there. Okay, if b square minus 4ac is less than 0. Understood? Fine. Now, one thing also should be noted over here. From this particular point, I am adding over there, it is also very important that while you are doing, suppose, take this equation. Okay. Very simple law is there, that is sum of two roots is equals to minus b by a, and product of two roots, that is nothing but equals to c by a. And these two rules are very, very, very popular and important when you are going to solve a problem for a quadratic equation. I can establish that particular thing by putting a simple example. I am just removing that part. Just putting a simple example, like suppose y square plus 6y minus 216 equals to 0. Okay, now just do the middle term factorization, or using these particular rules, formulas, you can use them also. So just find the what are the roots. You can use this particular formula, or you can do the middle term factorization by hook or by crook. Find the roots. So after solving the roots, I am getting two roots. They are basically, you can solve it also by your copy. Minus 18 and 12, I am getting these two roots are there. One factor will be x minus 12 and x plus 12, x minus 18. So that way I am getting these particular roots. You can solve them by using this formula easily, or you can do the middle term factorization. And now club this particular formula with them. See, sum of two roots. Sum of two roots means, what are they? Minus 18 plus 12, sum of two roots. Okay. And I told you that is equals to minus b by a. Minus b means 6 and a means 1. Ekana to yahan pe koi nahi hai, to yahan pe 1 hai basically. So minus b by a means minus 6 by 1, that is equals to minus 6. And you can see minus 18 plus 12, it will give you obviously minus 6. That way proved. And also product of two roots, that means minus 18 product with 12, and you can check, it will obviously giving you c by a. C by a means minus 216 by 1, so it will give you minus 216, and just you product them, you can get this value. So that way, by doing some practical observation, that two rules comes to us. They are not actually, there is nothing about any derivation in between these two law. Okay, by practical observation, by practical trial error, it has been checked that sum of two roots of a quadratic equation will be equal with minus b by a, and product of two roots of a quadratic equation must be equal with c by a. Okay, so that two formula can be used to solve a quadratic equation. Okay, next, moving on. Okay, now one problem is given like this, that 4x square plus 4 root 3x plus 3 equals to 0. And you are asked that find roots if they exist. Mind it, find roots if they exist by the method of completing the square. And the method is also mentioned over here, that which method you are going to adopt, that is the completing the square method. Completing the square method is nothing but you have to convert that equation in a square equation. Okay, that means a plus b whole square, like this kind of equation. So first you have to find that if there any chance that root is not there. So if the root is existing, then I told you that the b square minus 4ac term will be greater than equals to 0. So if I can say, if roots exist, then I can write that b square minus 4ac term will be greater than equal to 0. Okay, if it is greater than equal to 0, then their root will be exist, real roots, real distinct root will be there. If it is equals to 0, then root will be there, but only one root will be there, two roots will be equal, real and equal roots. And if this b square minus 4ac is less than 0, then that term basically no real roots will be there, there will be a imaginary root. Okay, so that way I can say that this term is nothing but, so I can find this particular value for this equation now, that here you can say that a is 4 in this equation. The standard form, I think you can remember, ax square plus bx plus c equals to 0, that is the standard form. So that way a is nothing but 4 and b is nothing but 4 root 3 and c is 3. Okay, so just find that what will be the b square minus 4ac expression value. Just put all those values over there and you can see that will giving you 4 root 3 square minus 4 into 3, 4ac. So after all it will produce you 0, because 4 root 3 square means 4 square means 16, 16 multiplied with 3, 48. Minus 48, it will produce you 0. So that means then real distinct roots exists. Okay, so there is this term. Now if they exist, yes, they are existing there, roots are there. Now find the roots by completing the square. So completing the square method means just you have to convert that expression 4 root 3x plus 3. Convert that equation by a square formula. Like you can convert easily like this way, 2x square plus 2 into 2x into root 3 plus root 3 square. So that way equals to 0. Oh sorry, equals to 0 is there. I missed that term. So that way I can write that 2x plus root 3 whole square is equals to 0. So it means 2x plus root 3 also equals to 0. And that way I can find x equals to minus root 3 by 2. And you can see, I told you just before that if that b square minus 4ac greater than 0, then that will be two distinct different roots are there. And if b square minus 4ac equal to 0, then the distinct roots are there, but both the roots are same. And you can see only one root is coming. That means two roots, they are equal with each other. That's why only one root is coming from there. Okay, so then real distinct roots exist and they are equal. So I can write over here equal real roots, because that b square minus 4ac here, that is equals to 0. If it is greater than 0, then two different real roots will be there. If it is equal to 0, then two real roots will be there, but they are equal kind of square. Okay, so that is also a problem which one is taken from a NCERT textbook. Moving again. Now this problem is given like this. You have to find the roots. The equation is look like 1 by x plus 4 minus 1 by x minus 7 equals to 11 by 30. And x not equal to minus 4 and 7. What does it mean? That means if you put x equals to minus 4, then that part will be 1 by 0. And if you put x equals to 7, similarly that term will be 0. So 1 by 0, 1 by 0, that will produce you infinity. So that is not actually solved, or that is not possible if it is equals to it 11 by 30. Okay, this one is infinity, that one is also infinity, and the subtraction of both of them is giving you 11 by 30. It is not justifying. That's why it is given that x not equal to minus 4 and 7. Now how it can be solved? Very easy way. Just make a subtraction, making LCM both of them. So x plus 4, so here it will be x minus 7 minus x minus 4 will be 11 by 30. So that way x and x will be cancelled. So if you just solve it, here it will come minus 11 and this side plus 11 is there. So 11, 11 will be cancelled, minus will be remain there. Just simplify that thing, it will giving you a quadratic equation which will look like x square minus 3x plus 2 equals to 0. Just make a simple solving, it will give you that. Now you can find out that particular root for this equation by adopting any method. You can adopt that equation for quadratic equation like minus b plus minus root over b square minus 4ac by twice a, first method. Second one, simple, that doing a middle term factorization method, 2x minus 2x minus x minus 3x will come. Third method, you can use the, convert that equation into completing the square method. That means use that equation just to in a form of a square equation. So that way also you can get the root of a equation. So middle term factorization is very simple. Suppose anybody ask you just to solve that particular equation using that completing the square method. So how it can be converted in a square form? So that way you can write it like this, x square minus 2 into x into 3 by 2 plus 3 by 2 square. Obviously 3 by 2 square minus bhi karna padega, plus 2 as it is it will be there. It's nothing but x square will be remain there. Minus 3x I have written like this way. You can see 2, 2 will be cancelled, 3x is there. And 3 by 2 square, while you are adding 3 by 2 square, then obviously subtracting 3 by 2 square must be there. And plus 2 remain there. Okay, the same thing we have done before also. So that way I can write that x minus 3 by 2 whole square. And if you solve these two part, minus 9 by 4 plus 2, if we solve it, so it will give you 1 by 4. So 1 by 4 minus 1 by 4 will come. If you send it on the right side, it will give you like this. Just a simple solution. So that way x minus 3 by 2, it will be equal with plus minus 1 by 2. So that way you can get that x, I can get obviously two terms, that x when it is minus 3 by 2 send on to right side, and when you are taking plus half with plus 3 by 2, two different roots will come. One will be half plus 3 by 2, and second term I am writing that one x1, and x2 I am writing minus half plus 3 by 2. So that way one root will be 2 and second root will be 1. So two different root I am getting. So obviously two different real distinct roots I am getting. Okay, so that way that equation also you can anybody can ask you that is it feasible or is it really existing any roots there. So that way you can find from there, just find b square minus 4ac term. If it is greater than 0, if it is equals to 0, and if it is less than 0, so you can conclude three conditions from there. And obviously this particular case it will be greater than 0 because two real and different distinct roots you are getting. So you can check it like this way. You just find b square minus 4ac from that particular equation and find is it greater than 0, less than 0 or equals to 0. And I can assure you that it will be greater than 0. You can check it out. Okay. So it is also a problem which one is taken from a NCERT textbook. Now one problem is given. It's some what statement or what problems. Like sum of the areas of two squares is 468 meter square. Two squares is given. Now the sum of two areas is 468 meter square. If the difference of their perimeter is 24 meter, find the sides of two square. This kind of statement problem frequently asked and they are very interesting to solve. So if I take two square, I told that one square I am taking like this one and the second square I am drawing with a black one. Okay, and this one I am taking y length any side and I am taking this one as x length. Okay, so by their given data I can form this kind of equation, x square plus y square, that is nothing but 468 meter square. One information is given like this. And second information is also given that there are difference in perimeter. So I can write 4x minus 4y, that way that is equals to 24 meter. These two equation we have, one equation and equation 2. Okay, so now you can solve these two equation just to find the value of x and y. You can solve it like adopting many ways or various ways. Like I can say x minus y from this equation, I can say that 4 will be cancelled with 24, that will giving you x minus y equals to 6. Okay, and if we solve this part of equation, that x a square plus b square, that formula can be written like this way, x minus y whole square plus 2xy, you know this formula, that is equals to 468. And if you put this x minus y value over there, so it will be giving you 6 square, that means 36. So from there you are getting just xy equals to 206. Just a simple simplification process, do it with your own pen and copy. So that way I am getting x equals to 216 by y. Now if we put this particular value on any equation, suppose I am putting this value onto this equation, so what it will give you, that x equals to 216 by y minus y, that equals to 6. And if you solve it or if you simplify it, it will give you finally a quadratic equation which is look like this. Now again solve it. This equation can be solved again by doing factorization method, or that means middle term splitting method, or you can use that b square minus 4ac over term. That way you can solve it and it will give you y plus 18. I am doing by using a middle term factorization method. So it will give you these things, or y equals to minus 18, or it will be equals to 12. Now which value is taken over here? Because I am taking y as a length of a square, so obviously this minus 18 value won't be accepted and it will be neglected. Why it is neglected? Because it's a negative value. Negative value. That's why it is neglected, because for a length part, the negative term should not be considered. Okay. So that way y equals to 12, this value will be accepted. If the y value is 12, then x value obviously will be plus 6. So from there, x will be 6 plus y, that means 12 plus 6, that will be 18. Okay, so find the sides of 2 square. This side will be 18 and that side will be 12. You can cross check with the values. Are they product of their square, sum of their square, is it producing 468? You can check. Now this is a statement. What problem is a very tricky one. It can be a very good problem. Like two water taps together can fill a tank in 9/3/8 hours. That means a tank is there and two different water taps are there to fill it. And if they both of the taps running with the same time, then they will fill the tank with this amount of time. The tap of larger diameter takes 10 hours less than the smaller one to fill the tank separately. So the bigger diameter taps obviously will take less time. So how much? It is 10 hours less to fill the tank if it is operated separately. Okay. Find the time in which each tap can separately fill the tank. You have to find the time if both of the taps operated separately or individually, then how much time will be taken for each tap. Okay, so it can be solved like this, taking that let bigger tap means a larger diameter tap, it takes x hours to fill the tank. Obviously, individually or separately. Similarly, smaller tap takes obviously 10 hours more. That is given, 10 hours difference is there. So 10 hours, x plus 10 hours to fill the tap. So by the problem, we can assume these two statements. Okay. Now one thing should be noted that if bigger tap, I am writing for bigger tap now. For bigger tap, I can say that in x hours it fills whole tank. Whole tank means we can say one part of the tank, because we assume that whole part, that means the one part of the tank. It's a simple unitary statement I am trying to develop. In x hours, the bigger tap fills one part of the tap, that means the whole part of the tank. So obviously I can find for this time means it is 75/8. So in 75/8 hours, it fills what amount of what part of the tank? That is 75/8x. It's a simple unitary method, nothing else. This part of the tank. So from here I can say that after running of these hours, the bigger tap will fill that part of the tank, not the whole tank, that part of the tank. And similarly for the smaller tap, that same kind of concept we can develop for the smaller tap also, that same kind of unitary method, that in x plus 10 hours, that time it fills whole part of the tank, that means one part of the tank. One part means a whole part, the full tank. And same way, I am finding for the same time being, that means 75/8 hours, it fills just the same thing. I can write like this, 75/8 into x plus 10, this part of the tank. So from here I can see that after running of this particular time being, the bigger tap will fill that part of the tank and the smaller tap will fill that part of the tank. Now from these two parts, what I am trying to achieve, these two parts, what they actually, after running of these two these hours, both of the tank taps, if it is operated at the same time, then what will happen? Then after running of these hours, they will fill the tank. That is told, two water taps together, they can fill a tank for this time being. So for this time being, the bigger tap will fill that part of tank and the smaller tap will fill that part of the tank. So by the problem, I am removing that part. Huh? So by that problem statement, now we can develop that. I can build this equation that by the problem, I can write like this, 75/8x for the bigger tap and the smaller tap 75 by 8 into x plus 10, that is equals to whole tank, that means that is equals to 1, because that is filled by the bigger tap and that is filled up the smaller tap, and both of them operated at the same time, then they will fill the whole tank. Whole tank means one part. Okay, so that equation can be developed by the problem statement. Now we have to solve this equation by doing the simple addition, having a LCM. You can solve that equation very easily, I think. Finally, it will give you a quadratic equation. I am writing the quadratic equation here. 8x square minus 70x minus 750. That kind of a quadratic equation, it will be developed. Just do a simple solving by your own copy and pen, you can get it. Okay, now after getting this kind of a quadratic equation, you can solve it by middle term factorization, but it is a very complex equation. So it is better to solve if you use that quadratic equation formula. So that way, I have used that thing, x can be find out by using that formula, minus b plus minus root over b square minus 4ac by 2iz, and in this particular, so if you try to solve it, you can see over here that I can write that a is nothing but 8, b is nothing but minus 70, and c minus 750. Just taking all these value and put them over there, from there you can easily solve, and you can, after solving, you can get that x equals to 15 and minus 25 by 4. These two values will come. You can, after solving, you can see over there. So obviously this minus 25 by 4 not accepted, not possible. So it is neglected, because it is basically x is the, I have assumed over here that x is nothing but a timing. So time cannot be a negative term. So obviously x is 15, that value will be accepted. So finally the answer of that particular problem will be x equals to 15 hours, that is taken by the 15 hours, that is for bigger tap. Bigger tap will take 15 hours, and obviously it will be added plus x plus 10, that is equals to 25 hours, and that is taken by the smaller tap. That time is taken by the smaller tab. Okay, so like this way you can solve several problems for any kind of quadratic equation. Mind it, always you have to remember this particular equation and what are the conditions based on which real roots, imaginary roots or equal roots can be achieved, as well as very well, by very good knowledge, you have to do the factorization method by completing the square principle. By middle term factorization, you have to find the roots of quadratic equation. Okay, I think it will be very clear to you people now. So if any kind of confusion, any kind of problems comes in your mind, then please comment it on my comment box. I will be getting back to you very soon. Okay, bye. From my side, cheers.